Good morning. Thank you so much for being with us this morning. I hope you've had a blessed week. A couple things as we get started here this morning. I just want to remind you that next week we will be honoring our seniors. And so that will be a time where we will have them be able to be here and be present with us. And we get to just take the morning to recognize them and honor them as they start their summer off and get ready for college in the fall. So hope you'll join us for that. Continue to lift up this congregation and our board as we just go through the transition and try out the reentry plan and just work through that. There's a lot of different things that have to be discussed and really agreed upon when we start that and when we do that. And so I just please ask for prayers for that as we do continue to work through all that as well. So we're going to open with a word of prayer this morning. I ask you to bow your head and join me. Dear Father, thank you for today that we have another day that is just a gift from you, that we can be together in spirit, that we can be surrounded by you no matter where we are, that your Holy Spirit and your presence just can fill our lives. And so today, in this time of turmoil and chaos, we ask for just a moment of peace and a moment of comfort for everyone here, but all those at home, that we can take this time to just be able to just soak in your loving embrace, and that this can be a time that we can just feel you surround us. We give you all the praise and all the thanks. In your name we pray. Amen. So I just invite you this morning to join us as we open up with the Spirit song. Yeah.
worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship Your holy name.
We're going to sing that again. Invite you to join me this morning on our call to worship. We gather this day from a week filled with needs and demands. We come to find rest and renewal of our spirits. Open your hearts in love to hear the voice of God. We want to quietly rest in God's presence, free from the clamor of this world. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. We're going to continue with Thy Word.
Thy Word is a lamp unto my
our congregational prayer, if you'll join me. Triune God, we rejoice in this set-apart time where we once again orient our lives around You. You know our plight. We are weak, estranged, wandering, and lost. Seeking to stand in our own strength, we fall. Strangers to Your holiness, we wander. Defenseless against evil within and without, we are lost. In this time of worship, shine Your light in our darkness and guide us back to our place in You. God, our strength, We lean into your everlasting, never failing presence. When it comes time for us to depart, cause us to boldly witness to the gospel, welcome the stranger, and to pursue peace, leaning on you as we navigate through the struggles of our times. Amen.
Good morning. I greet you this Trinity Sunday, this Peace and Justice Sunday, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, three revelations of our one true God. I don't know if you were listening, I hope you were listening and following along with the slides this morning as we came together in worship, as we sang about the presence of the Spirit in this place and 10,000 reasons for our hearts to sing. And then we were singing, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto thy path." So we have this language of lamp and light, and we know that in this life, you and I walk in darkness. We walk in shadow times. And even in the history of who Jesus is or who God is, how God has revealed God's self, God has done that. In fire, God has done that with clouds. There is this thing that you and I learn that we don't ever fully, clearly see God, but we seek God. We seek God through Scripture. We seek God through our traditions, our experiences, and our ability to reason. And one of the things that you and I are going to do today is we are going to journey that path and ask God to shine some light on that path, so that we might have clarity of who God is for each of us. That is the question today. Who is God to you? And why does it matter? Now, if you were following the slides, there came a slide where there was a missing word. And that word was love. And that word is love. And John Wesley, who is the founder of Methodism, John Wesley would say, if we could sum up God in one word, that word would be love. And as we look at God today, we are going to talk a bit about Trinity God. And I want to say why this is important as we step into this. Why it is important is that while there are other faith traditions that might talk about love, in the Christian faith tradition, we say that God is love. And in the midst of what Karl Barth would say, Karl Barth being a theologian, a God thinker, someone who thinks a lot about God, who was alive around he's a German theologian, so much of what informed him was the Holocaust experience and Nazism and the presence and at times the absence of church. And Karl Barth, in his teaching, would say, you know, God discloses God's self in faith traditions and in philosophies. But what God does in Christianity is God reveals God's self in Jesus Christ. And part of what you and I are going to wrestle with today is who God is to us. And I want to say on the front end, our answer matters. Because you and I, we are the living witnesses of our God. So I want to just take you back to Moses for a second before we dip into today's scripture. So going back to Moses, we know that God gave Moses God's name in a fire, right? The burning bush, the bush that was not consumed by fire. And the way the Hebrew tradition or the Jewish tradition would take the name Yahweh, they believe that God is so big that our minds and our hearts can't fully capture who God is. So they wouldn't speak the name. So they took if we use the English letters, they took the letters YHWH. And they added the vowels, if you will, the breath marks of Adonai, which means Lord. So they added that, and that is where the word Jehovah comes from. And Jehovah, in some way, says that we can't fully understand who God is. And as mere mortals, as God's creation, we should never be so arrogant to believe that we could even give God a full name. And so they created that name, the name Jehovah, to acknowledge that God is the Lord of our lives. And that as we know God as Lord, as Savior, as friend, as we know God in all of that, there will always be mystery. There will always be a reason you and I should continue to dip into Scripture and to have conversation with one another and to read people who think about God and people who think God doesn't exist. It's so important to read and to continue to grow, because we never fully reach our understanding of who God is. But we do know that God is love. I want to read to you from Matthew 28, beginning with verse 16. These are the final words of Jesus, and the final words are important words. And I invite for you to hear these. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And remember, I am with you always, to the end of the age." The word of God for God's people. Thanks be to God. Amen. So you think about that last directive, the Great Commission that we receive from Jesus. And sometimes we land only on one part, but there are three parts. We go and we baptize. And we do so in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the triune God. And I want to say that triune God didn't first show up in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. God has always been God. And even in Genesis, when God speaks and God says, "Let us make creation, let us make humankind in our image," God speaks in this plural language. So the triune God is not something that humankind has created, but we use the word Trinity or triune to help understand who God is, God who has revealed God's self as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And Jesus' commission, his words to us, is that you baptize, you teach, and you remember. I mean, think about that with me for a second. We baptize, we teach, and we remember. And I think we can fully understand what it means to baptize and to teach. And when it comes to remembering, it means not only knowing who God is and how God has revealed God's self over time, and remembering our place, our finding our place in God's greater story, but to remember also means to bring together those parts that are separate. So we are, as followers of Christ, as disciples of Jesus, we are to baptize, to teach, and to remember. And I want to say that these last few months with St. Paul's United Methodist Church have been a gift to me. And I hope that my time with you in leading worship has been a gift for you. Next Sunday, which is technically my final Sunday, we will be celebrating our graduating seniors. So this is really my last message, my last moment with you all. And I was thinking, what is the, if Jesus is, if the last words of Jesus are the important words, right? To baptize, to teach, to remember. What are my important words? What are the leave with you words that I want to give you as we part yet remain connected as we are as the body of Christ and in the United Methodist Church? And I think my last words are more of a question. Who is God to you? And why does it matter? Who is God to you? You know, St. Augustine, I don't know if you've heard of him, but St. Augustine had this phrase that I want to give you today. And that phrase is, si comprendis, non est Deus, right? It means, if you believe you fully understand God, you don't, right? And it is so important for us to think about who God is and how God is in this world, in part because, just look at our world. And the division that's happening there. And if God is love, and I believe that God is love, and if the fruit of the Spirit or the fruit of God shows up in our lives in love and gentleness, self-control, peace, joy, those nine fruit of the Spirit, as God's love is manifested in our lives, I was thinking of this question on my drive today from Altoona to Williamsburg on how was God before creation started, right? Before God began this wonderful journey with creation, in the beginning. Because God pre-exists Genesis, right? So who is God and how is God? And I think that God's character is part of the reason that you and I need to wrestle with the question of who God is in our lives and why it matters. You see, I believe that God was love and is love, and it isn't because of a result of creation or the things that God has done, Genesis to Revelation and beyond, but there is a central character about who God is that we, as followers of Jesus, can claim and live into in our lives. When we look at divisions, right, when we look at our attitudes, our actions, I want to give us a challenge today, if that is all right. I want you to think about the time that you give to things in this world. So it might be the time that you give to Netflix and what you're watching, or Hulu, or the time that you give to watching a particular news channel, a time that you give to getting lost in Facebook, and how we invest our time. Because those things that we are investing in, they feed us, right? We become what we eat. And it's not just physical stuff, but where we invest our emotional energy, our mental energy, our spiritual energy, whatever we are feasting on, we become. And I invite you to do this exercise for those of you that are in, I'll use Facebook for an example. Look at your last, let's say, 10 posts, just the last 10 posts. Or the last 10 text messages that you have sent, or the last 10 conversations that you have had. As those who are to make disciples, who are to teach, who are to remember, how are we doing at expressing who God is in this world? Are we about division, or are we about multiplication, right? Discipleship is about multiplication. Are we about the things that separate us, or the things that bring us together? And what informs us? And I want to encourage you that if it is not yet a habit, to get into Scripture regularly, because when we get into Scripture regularly, then Scripture lives in us, right? The more we spend time in reading the Bible, the more we have that voice or that witness speaking to us. And as we form opinions, especially in this season of division in our nation and our world, we can sit with the question behind that of what Scripture or what Christian tradition or what experience of God has happened that is forming my opinion on something because we are, after all, God's witnesses in this world. What we say and how we say it, what we do and how we do it, is our witness. It is our witness of being a disciple. It is our witness of teaching. It is our witness of remembering people to God. And it is the way that we answer the question, who God is to us. You see, God and how we understand God and who we understand God to be cannot be reserved only for a time of worship, right? How God guides us, how God leads us, how God loves us, and how we respond to that necessarily needs to be part of who we are and how we are in this world. And there have been times, and today is Trinity Sunday, and there are times where people have said to me, who had not heard about Jesus before, they had been raised completely unchurched, and they would say to me, don't you all really have three gods? Like, you talk about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Are these really three gods? And Augustine and Karl Barth and John Wesley and Scripture itself reminds us of that old hymn that we may sing on occasion, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, the Blessed Trinity, right? These three persons, these three revelations of God. And part of the importance of understanding triune God is that when we give part of our attention, if you will, to God, Creator, Redeemer, Sanctifier, God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, if we only lean into one aspect of God's character in God's revelation, then we are leaving a portion of who God is out. And the way that Augustine would talk about triune God, Trinity God, is that if God is love, and God is the essence of love, we have God the lover, right? So God the lover, who is Creator God, Father God, Jesus the beloved, the manifestation of God in this world, and then the Holy Spirit, something about that inner relationship, that intra-relationship that binds our bonds God's, the character of God or the personhood of God together. And the way that I want us to maybe wrap our minds around that a little bit is, say, for example, and I know I've referenced this a couple of times in my time here at St. Paul's, but say, for example, you are a child, a friend, and a parent, right? And you can self-reflect on how your experience as a parent has led you to a greater understanding of what it meant to be a child raised by your parents, right? Or your experience with your parent or your child informs how you are a friend to others. And I think that when we pay attention, or we lean into and we think about God as triune God, and that interactivity that God reveals as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that we have this learning that just as God is, you and I become. So this internal stuff that goes on inside of us, the way that we have been in relationship even with ourselves in the different roles that we have in our world, that we offer grace to ourselves, our love to ourselves, so that we can be at our best in each of these roles. And Augustine would say that about the Trinity, that when we look at God as Father, Son, Holy Spirit, these are not three little gods. It is one amazing God who reveals God's self in these three ways. And as I said, part of the reason that it's important for us to be able to talk about this diversity that is God, and that God, through the power of the Spirit, shines a light on the path of our faith journey and our relationship journey, is because you and I, as disciples of Jesus, are those called to not only live as disciples, but make new disciples, and to teach, and to remember. And when I was at my final church appointment before moving to conference staff, I was having a conversation one day with a person who no longer had a home. So they were living on the street. And they, on occasion, would find their way into a shelter. But the shelters were so overcrowded that that oftentimes by the time they arrived, there would be no more space for them. And oftentimes our shelters would open door first for our for women and children. And there would be times where unfortunately, because of the epidemic of homelessness, a number of men would be left out for the night. And on Tuesdays, we had a ministry called Tuesday Ministry. It seemed to be a good name for a Tuesday ministry. And on Tuesdays, we would serve a population of folks that were in deep need. And we wouldn't only serve their physical needs, but we would have conversations. So we had a team of folks, five or six folks, that would meet with these individuals who would come in specifically on Tuesdays, and we would have conversation. Well, one of the gentlemen who came in had been, he had slept outside the previous couple of nights, and Mikey came in and sat down at the desk and began to tell a bit of his story. And his story revealed that in every way that life could be hard, life was hard on him. His parents had both passed away when they were very young, and he was very young. He was passed from home to home until he was 16 years old, and he had been so caught in the system that when he was 16, he ran away, because running away seemed for him the best option of how to get ahead in life or to even have some anchoring of self-determination and relationship. But Mikey had spent 20 years of his life on the streets. So there is suddenly this 36-year-old man who honestly looked older than I am. He came and he was visiting with me. And we usually the questions that we received were how to receive health care, assistance with homes or with housing, transportation, driver's license, social, those are usually the questions they would ask. But Mikey was sitting across from me at my desk, and I said, "Mikey, do you have any questions, any other questions today?" And he said this, "Who is God? Who is this God that you guys talk about?" And I said, "Well, what do you mean?" And he said, "Well, I think my question was the question, who is God?" And I sat there for a moment with him, and I said, "You know, Mikey, I don't know fully who God is, because I don't know that any of us fully know, but I know how God is. God is a God of love, and so we love. And God is a God of sacrifice, so we sacrifice. God is a God of relationship. And so not only do we seek relationship with God, but we seek relationship with one another. God is the God who so loved the world that in a mystery we don't fully understand, God came to us in and through Jesus, who lived the human experience so that you and I know that there is nothing that we go through that God's self doesn't go through. And God gives us this promise that even though we don't fully see God with our eyes, the Spirit of God is present with us always." And then I showed him the words, these last words that Jesus spoke. Jesus, who is a revelation of our triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. These last words where Jesus said, "You baptize in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit." and you teach, and you remember. And I said that to Mikey, and Mikey was sitting there. He got tears in his eyes, and he said, "Do you think that God remembers me?" And I said, "Absolutely." And he said, do you think that God knows me?" I said, "Absolutely, Mikey." And he said, "Well, and you think even though God remembers and God knows, God still loves me?" And I said to Mikey, "God is love. To do anything less than love is counter to the character of God." And we talked, and he shared more of his story that was heartbreaking. He shared more of his journey on the streets from being a 16-year-old to heading toward 40-year-old. And I want to say that Mikey began to show up for worship. And he didn't always quite make it into the sanctuary, but he sit outside and sit out in this thing called the Centrix. That's like a narthex. It's a gathering space in the church. Mikey would sit there and he'd listen to the service over the speaker. And we said to him one time, "Mikey, why don't you come all the way into the sanctuary?" And he said, "I wouldn't want anybody to be uncomfortable, and I stink." And I said, "Mikey, that there is space for you in the sanctuary. We've been saving a pew just for you." And the next week he came, and you could watch as he would sit in the back, move to the middle, to the front. And that was all in one service. He would just move around a lot during the service, but he was paying attention to the way that we would talk about our God, who is love, who has revealed God's self as Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and that we would confess that we don't have all the answers. That would be idolatrous of us to believe that we have all the answers to who God is. It would be a mistake for us to think that our human mind and our human heart could fully encapsulate who God is. But we would say to Mikey and to the congregation, "But we have the questions, and we know the one who has the answers, who is the answer, so we're going to just get together and love." Well, I want to confess that Mikey, as much as he would show up, he still lived a pretty rough life because he spent the majority of his time on the streets. And he experienced... you know, in the state of Iowa, we have redemption cans. I love the word redemption. That's an important word in our faith tradition. But we have redemption cans where you get money back for turning cans in. And there was a time that Mikey was stabbed during when he was canning, which is when you go through stuff like old big garbage bins to look for cans. There was a time where Mikey was taken to the emergency room, and once they found out he was homeless, they called in guards to watch him in case he was a threat. And then there came a time where Mikey was arrested and went to jail for a season of almost 30 days. And this is where Mikey witnessed to me and to my co-pastor who our triune God is. The God who invites us to follow as disciples. The God who reminds us to always be in a teaching spirit and a learning spirit. And the God who remembers us. We went to the jail in Pottawatomie County to visit Mikey. And we were let in, and we're on the other side of that plexiglass, bulletproof glass, that thing that separates the prisoner from the visitor. And you have the phone that you can pick up so that you can communicate to one another. So the conversation was this: "Mikey, how are you doing?" And he talked a bit about forced sobriety and how that was a good thing for him, and that meals were good, and that the deputies and the jailers were treating him really, really well. And then by the time we got to the end of the conversation, when I would normally say, is there anything else that we can do? Mikey did this. Hey, before you guys leave, would it be okay if I pray for you? And I caught my breath, as did my co-pastor. And we said, absolutely. And Mikey's prayer was this: God, you are love, and you love us, and thank you for that. And then he prayed God's protection and God's goodness on the ministry of the church I was serving at the time. And in his prayer, he gave thanks to God for leading him to that church that welcomed him and saw him, who invited him to be a disciple, who invited him to classes so that he could learn and he could share and be also a teaching voice, and who invited him in a way that he was remembered or brought back into the body of Christ. And he prayed a beautiful prayer of thanksgiving. I want to say to you that when Mikey got out of jail, we never saw him again. He didn't show back up to the church. When he got out of jail, life continued for him in some way. But there was a thing that he was doing while in jail. He was reading the Bible every single day. And he had the same prayer every single day. God, you've shown up as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Show up in me so that in me you show up to others. That's why you and I need to explore the question who God is to us and why it matters. It matters because the world is hungry to know God, who is love. The world is hungry to know a God who loves unconditionally. The world is hungry to know that those who are followers of Jesus Christ spend as much time with Jesus, if not more, that as we do watching Netflix or hanging out on Facebook or watching certain news channels. The world needs to know that our positions and our attitude and our gratitude is grounded in the scriptures, and everything that we believe is not defined by a region or a political party or anything like that, but every belief that we have, we can go to the biblical story that informs what we believe and why we believe it. You see, going back to that first song, sometimes it feels like love is omitted. But you and I, as disciples of Jesus, we are the insertion of love in this world, as God loves us and God loves through us. And even as the Spirit is light unto the path that you and I are on, God uses us in a mystery bigger than I understand to be light for the world and love for the world. And so, my friends, think about who God is to you and why it matters. And consider how you are in all moments, at all times, a witness to God. God's love, God's light, God's goodness, God who has revealed God's self as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Consider how you are always a witness in everything that you do, everything that you say, everything that we text, everything that we post, every interaction that we have with another. We are God's witnesses in this world. Are we witnesses to that love and light? I pray to God that we are. Amen.
Walking around these walls, by now they'd fall.
So go in peace, and may God's peace go with you. Bring hope and healing to all you meet. Amen.